Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worldly magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Let your continual mercy, O Lord, cleanse and defend your church. Because it cannot continue in safety without your help, protect and govern it always by your goodness, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. Vanity of vanities, says the teacher. Vanity of vanities, all is vanity. I, the teacher, when king over Israel in Jerusalem, applied my mind to seek and to search out by wisdom all that is done under heaven. It is an unhappy business that God has given to human beings to be busy with. I saw all the deeds that are done under the sun, and see all is vanity and is chasing after wind. I hated all my toil in which I had toiled under the sun, seeing that I must leave it to those who come after me. And who knows whether they will be wise or foolish? Yet they will be master of all for which I toiled and used my wisdom under the sun. This also is vanity. So I turned and gave my heart up to despair concerning all the toils of my labors under the sun, because sometimes one who has toiled with wisdom and knowledge and skill must leave all to be enjoyed by another who did not toil for it. This is also vanity and a great evil. What do mortals get from all the toil and strain with which they toil under the sun? For all their days are full of pain, and their work is a vexation. Even at night, their minds do not rest. This also is vanity. The word. word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God. The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 49, and we will read together. Hear this, all you people. Hearken, all you who dwell in the world, you of high degree and low, rich and poor together. My mouth shall speak of wisdom, and my heart shall meditate on understanding. I will incline my ear to a proverb and set forth my riddle upon the harp. Why should I be afraid in evil days, when the wickedness of those at my heels surrounds me? The wickedness of those who put their trust in their goods and boast of their great riches. We can never ransom ourselves or deliver to God the price of our life. For the ransom of our life is so great that we should never have enough to pay it. In order to live forever and ever, and never see the grave. For we see that the wise die also, like the dull and stupid they perish, and leave their wealth to those who come after them. Their graves shall be their homes forever, their dwelling places from generation to generation, though they call the lands after their own names. Even though honored, they cannot live forever. They are like leeches.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Colossians. If you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When God, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever in you is earthly: fornication, impurity, passion, evil desire, and greed, which is idolatry. On account of these, the wrath of God is coming on those who are disobedient. These are the ways you also once followed when you were living that life, but now that you must get rid of all such things: anger, wrath, malice, slander, and abusive language from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have stripped off the old self with its practices and have clothed yourself with the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge according to the image of the Creator. In that renewal, there is no longer Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave and free, but Christ is all and in all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Someone in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me." But he said to him, "Friend, who set me to be a judge or arbitrator over you?" And he said to them, and he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly, and he thought to himself, "What should I do? For I have no place to sow my crops." Then he said, "I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, 'Soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you. And the things you have prepared, whose will they be?' So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich toward God." The gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Please be seated. I saw a televised interview of a celebrity. I'm not sure who it was, but I guess it's, as I say, someone who's famous for being famous, so some people know who she was. But in the course of the conversation, she told the interviewer that she'd been depressed because she'd had many plastic surgeries, and she'd spent a lot of time tweaking them, going back for more. And she said she was doing that because she was searching for perfection, always feeling inadequate because of the images she saw projected on social media and other places, looking at other women who looked better than she did, she thought. And she thought maybe she could achieve that look if she had one more procedure. But she found that it really didn't help her at all, and she just left her feeling depressed. And then in a recent conversation with a friend who's been having a hard time, she was, I would say, alternately agitated and depressed, and she struggled to understand why she was feeling the way she was feeling, what was going on. She has a reasonably good life, a good job, a nice place to live, friends, but there's something wrong. She can't put a finger on it. And she realized that part of it may have to do with how much time she has spent on social media, and that it sucks up a lot of her time, she says, and just edges out all kinds of other things that she could be doing. And the main thing she says is, like, it's in her face, all this thing about other people's lives, about their pursuits, you know, what they're doing, what they've accomplished, the latest successes, what they've got, the toys, new love relationships, great trips, everything's in your face, and makes her feel inadequate, like she needs a life, as if she doesn't really have one right now. And she realizes she's felt envious of others, and she can't shake this feeling because she's constantly comparing herself to others and how they're living their lives according to what they're putting out. And she says she feels like a voyeur, and that it is a source of her agitation. She realized in talking about it that that was what was going on with her. And made her question, like, well, what am I really doing? Am I really accomplishing anything? And she just felt like she wasn't measuring up to all these people and her peers, particularly if they were people that she knew. And of course, as we know, that few people, unless they really want a lot of attention, don't broadcast their struggles, right? They don't tell you about their woes and the dark corners of their lives on Facebook or Instagram or Twitter, unless they want a lot of attention. No, they always put the best foot forward, right? The smiles, the great trip. Many times they keep all that other stuff to themselves, the darker stuff. And so we don't really see that, and we just see what they want to project, the positive image. And so, you know, we live in a society where we're always looking at what other people are doing, and particularly because it's in our faces all the time. And you know, just chatting over the back fence with somebody can send you off on a tangent. Oh, gee, how come they got that? How could they afford that? How come we can't do that? And then there are the things that we see other people doing and feeling that we should have or we should look like them. And then there's all of our stuff, are physical things. We have a lot of stuff, if you're honest with yourself. I know I do, I confess I do, and I'm working on getting rid of a lot of my stuff now, but we have a lot of it. I did I Googled self-storage, just for the heck of it, and the self-storage industry says that in 2020, globally, the expenditure on self-storage units is $48 billion. And they project in 2026, it's going to be up to $64 billion. And someone once pointed out that, you know, you spend the first two-thirds of your life acquiring things, and then the final third trying to get rid of it. And you know about that. You know about what it means to try to get rid of stuff. If you ever downsized to another place where you didn't have as much room and you had to get rid of some things, it wasn't just moving, you had to get rid of some things. Or if you, like I, have had to clear a house following the death of a relative or a friend, you know what it means to try to get rid of all that stuff. And sometimes it's beautiful stuff, right? In my aunt's case, she had beautiful things. She was always buying beautiful things. But we had to do something with it. And you find out that, and when you come to these times, and particularly now, that all those things that people spent so much money on and longed for and saved up for, fine china, crystal, silver, porcelain figurines, all that hope chest stuff, some of you know what I mean about a hope chest. Some of you may be too young, but many of us know what a hope chest was, right? All those things. Nobody wants it. If you tried to get rid of any of that, you could try to price it. You can't even give it away. No thanks, particularly younger people. They're not interested in that stuff. My poor grandchild is going to inherit a lot of stuff. But I'm thinking that all those things that we say we need and stress and strain to achieve, whether it's things, objects, or positions, or titles, or looks, or money, I decided to start calling those our American idols, the things that we worship. This morning, we heard from Ecclesiastes, who starts off saying, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. Ecclesiastes is a kind of disheartening book about life, but basically he's saying, none of this matters, all this stuff that we're worried about. The word vanity here is translated, means vapor or breath, something futile or vain, something that's going to disappear, something transitory. And he says it's just vapor. All is vanity and a chasing after wind. All this striving and busyness and working to acquire things and toil and strain that we think is accomplishing something isn't really accomplishing anything. It's just going to fade away. The 19th century poet William Wordsworth summed it up when he said, the world is too much with us, late and soon. Getting and spending, we lay waste our powers. Ecclesiastes says, it's all for naught. All this striving, except maybe if you're striving after God. In that case, then there's something. You got something there. So the question for us is, what are we supposed to be doing? What is important? We get messages from our culture which tells us, this is important, this is important. You should have this, you should look like that, you should aspire to this. But what is really important? If all that we focus on and think is so important is really transitory, then what? In this morning's gospel, this kind of issue is highlighted. Jesus tells a parable about a man who is so rich and has so many crops that he needs to provide more storage for all of it, to build bigger barns, so that he'll have enough and that he can relax the rest of his life, not realizing that he's not going to live very long. His life will be demanded of him very soon. I think in many ways that we are constantly in danger of building bigger and bigger barns for ourselves of one sort or another, of looking for ways to store up what we deem are the riches of life, more and more things that we think will make us feel better and more secure. Those barns look different for each of us. For him, it was grain. For us, it could be adult toys, what I call adult toys. For another, it can be accumulating money. For some, it's an impressive position, a title put on our resume to achieve a certain look, such as people who go through lots and lots and lots of plastic surgery. The possibilities are as varied as each one of us, but the motivation is the same. We're trying to feel better about ourselves and our lives and feel more secure. I think it comes down to needs versus wants. And sometimes we confuse the two. We want lots of things, but what do we really need? We have a problem of wants. We want more and more and more. And somehow we feel that nailing that down will make life more manageable and meaningful if we get those things. And it keeps us in that, we're sort of like a hamster wheel. We keep going round and round and round and round. In the 4th century, St. Augustine said, "You have made us for yourself, O Lord, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you." And God's take on the rich man this morning is that richness comes from relationship to God. That's where the richness in life comes. And that's the message for us this morning. Last week's gospel was all about the Lord's Prayer, and I preached about that a lot. It's a prayer that we recite in almost every service that we have, morning prayer, evening prayer, noonday prayer, compline, Eucharist. Almost every service we have, we recite the Lord's Prayer. But there's a crucial phrase in there. It says, "Give us," in Luke it says, "Give us each day our daily bread." The phrase "each day" is something I think we need to focus on, because it signals that there's something that we need every day. We don't need a new car every day. We don't need a new watch every day. We don't need a new nose every day. But there is something that we need every day. What is that? What is our daily bread? What is it that we have that we're asking of God? I think we've lost the sense of what daily bread is, of that thing that is God's way of providing for us day to day. In John 6, Jesus says, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." And that's what Colossians is trying to get us to think about today. Colossians was written to a church that was being pulled in different directions, as happened early in Christianity. There were lots of forces on the church, the young church, and the people were being pulled in different directions, getting lots of different messages. And so the letter to them encourages them to focus on Christ as their Lord, as the unifying power in their lives. No matter what they were getting from outside, from the culture, from the surrounding, their surroundings, to have a laser-like focus on Christ. And it says, to seek and set our mind on things that are above and not things that are on earth. And Colossians says, if you have been raised with Christ. And I think that's the question. If we are raised with Christ. It's a challenging statement. If you've been raised with Christ, then what is it that you focus on? We have a life in which things have taken God's place as primary in our lives. But if we've been raised with Christ, and I think probably we have to be raised every day over and over again just to fight what's coming at us. If we've been raised with Christ, then we are called to live a different kind of life. And perhaps it's a question we should ask ourselves periodically. Am I acting like I've been raised with Christ today? Am I feeling that today? Sort of like doing a personal audit periodically, which is not a bad thing to do. We audit our expenses. Sometimes we need to audit our spirit and just say, where am I? Check in with ourselves. Where are we with Christ? Have we been raised with Christ? If we've been raised with Christ, we can find release from our restlessness, from our tendency to want to acquire things over and over and get more and more things. We can be rescued from a tendency to build bigger and bigger barns out of fear, out of sense of lack, or out of greed. We can be freed from an attachment to things that are going to fade away, that when we fade away, somebody's going to be left to dispose of them, and nobody's going to want them. if we're raised with Christ, can keep us from being seduced by the vanities of our lives. And it can help us find our way to that daily bread, to the riches that we have from God. But as one person has noted, to become aware of God, first we must become aware of what we find more interesting than God. Amen. Please stand and let us affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. The third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world.
Continues with the prayers of the people, and I should please respond by saying, hear our prayer. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant Almighty God that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We remember especially those for whom prayers have been asked, as Brian, Hayden, Kay, Patty, Marcus, Roger, Allison, Patrick, Phoebe, Keith, and Walter. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We remember those who are suffering from the weather disaster and the storm and rain. those who have died from them and their families who have been displaced. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
The flowers on the altar are given in memory of Erica Dixon. We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your way, for the glory of your name. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Please stand as you are able. My sisters and brothers, the peace of the Lord be always with you. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us in offering and sacrifice to God. right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of life and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you've made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your words spoken through the prophets, and above all in the Word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and the Redeemer of the world. In him you've delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. The night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presented to you from your creation, this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where, with all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we have all to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the peace. Alleluia.
The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Christ. Body of Christ, the better. Body of Christ, the better. Body of Christ, the better. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Please stand as you're able. Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage, hold fast to what is good, render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, help the afflicted, honor everyone, love and serve your God. And may the blessing of God Almighty be with you and remain with you this day and forevermore.
Thank you.
power of the Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.